Well, welcome everyone. This is Lauren Wenzel at the National Marine Protected Areas Center, and we're very happy to be hosting this webinar with OCTO on conservation connections, species and places. And this is about NOAA's Partnership for Transboundary Protection. And we have two speakers with us today, and I'll introduce them. But before I do, I just want to remind you that we want to encourage your questions and comments. So please do go ahead and use the question box on the webinar interface so that we can hear from you. And after the presentation, we will go through your questions and comments and have a discussion with our speakers. So today we have with us Lee Karuba, who began her federal career with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers Regulatory Division and later worked for the U.S. EPA's lab in Athens, Georgia. And then she started working for NOAA in Puerto Rico in 2001 in charge of the Caribbean Field Office under the Habitat Conservation Division, and then in the Protected Resources Division. And she joined the Office of Protected Resources in January 2017, and one of her tasks is to lead the Partnership for Transboundary Protection. And our other speaker is Vicki Waddell, who is the Acting Chief of Policy and Planning for NOAA's Office of National Marine Sanctuaries. And before this position, she served as the National Coordinator for Permits, Consultations, and Environmental Compliance with the same office. She has experience in regulatory development and coordination of sanctuary management plan reviews. And she was an alumna of the John Canals Marine Policy Fellowship and graduated from Oregon State University with a Master's of Science, and before that from Ohio University with a Bachelor's of Science in Marine Biology. So welcome to you both, and I will turn it over to Lee to get us started.
Thanks, Lauren. So in the spirit of the collaboration, which is NOAA's Partnerships for Transboundary Protection, as Lauren has mentioned, we're going to transfer back and forth between Vicki and myself on this presentation. And I'm just going to kick it off with a brief introduction to what the program is. Basically, the Office of Protected Resources and the Office of National Marine Sanctuaries lead the program jointly. We started it several years ago, but it officially became a program that we are working towards implementing when the Office of Protected Resources Director signed a memo in August of 2017, formally establishing it. And since that time, we've worked together to add additional partners from inside and outside of NOAA, establish program priorities, and really explore the benefits of the collaboration. So as a bit of background, our two offices, the Office of Protected Resources and the Office of National Marine Sanctuaries, recognized that we had a lot of overlapping mandates that could be used as a partnership so that we could further the conservation and recovery efforts for listed species, as well as potentially furthering efforts towards management and conservation of other NOAA resources. So the purposes of the Partnerships for Transboundary Protection program is really to build these collaborative partnerships so we can spur creativity in linking and aligning place-based conservation with species conservation efforts within and beyond U.S. waters. And just to give you an idea of how and why we're working together, but also the kind of different perspectives of our two offices, and I apologize because that's actually a little bit hard to read, at least on my screen, but the point is to show you that in the left-hand side on the bottom, you have an example of some turtle nesting beaches, but also those numbers, the one and the three, for instance, in the Atlantic Ocean, show you just this really broad range that we consider in the Office of Protected Resources when we're working with species like sea turtles, in this case, the green sea turtle that has distinct population segments listed under the Endangered Species Act. So we have this really broad range for the species, the entire range of the species, whereas the map up on the top of the Florida Keys National Marine Sanctuary and adjacent protected areas shows you that the Office of National Marine Sanctuaries is really this place-based, like I mentioned in the previous slide. So there are listed species, though, within the sanctuary, like the green sea turtle, so we can take advantage of our two overlaps here in order to work towards this species and place-based conservation. So to go into a little more detail about our particular office, We have a mission to recover and conserve protected resources through actions to reduce threats to species and enhancing species health based on expertise in science-based policy and management. And we accomplish our mission in collaboration with our regional offices, science centers, and other partners both within and outside NOAA. Our domestic statutes like the Endangered Species Act and National Marine Sanctuaries Act only give authority for protection in U.S. waters. So because transboundary species like the humpback whale shown here in this photo use waters in important places, including some existing or future in-process marine protected areas of other countries, we do need help in protecting these shared species in special places. So the Partnerships for Transboundary Protection Program is meant to be a vehicle to establish and strengthen connectivity among scientists, managers, conservationists, and others who aim to protect biological and ecological connectivity of these transboundary species that have these wide ranges. So now I'll switch over to Vicki.
Excellent. So the Office of National Marine Sanctuaries is located within the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration as well. And what we are really is underwater parks. We're the federal program within NOAA that's charged with managing national marine sanctuaries. And we serve as the trustee for a network of underwater parks that encompass more than 600,000 square miles of marine and Great Lakes waters. Lee, can you go back to the other slide? So this on our slide is our vision and mission, and it's from our recently published in September of 2017. We published a 5-year plan for advancing protection of our amazing ocean and Great Lakes places that we manage. To accomplish this vision and mission, we work with diverse partners as well and stakeholders to promote responsible, sustainable ocean uses that ensure the health of these valued ocean and Great Lakes places. The National Marine Protected Area Center, as part of ONMS, is the nation's hub for building innovative partnerships and tools to protect our ocean. Next slide. So the National Marine Sanctuary System that's shown in this map includes 13 National Marine Sanctuaries and the Papahana, Mukuakea, and Rose Atoll Marine National Monuments. Few places on the planet, we think, can compete with the diversity of the National Marine Sanctuary System, which protects America's most iconic natural and cultural marine resources. Mm-hmm. Sanctuary habitats include beautiful rocky reefs, kelp forests, whale migration corridors, and feeding and calving grounds. Also spectacular deep sea canyons and underwater archaeological sites. We raise public awareness of sanctuary resources and conservation issues through scientific research, monitoring, exploration, education, and outreach programs. And we provide oversight and coordination of the sanctuary system by setting priorities and addressing resource management issues and directing program and policy development. From restaurants and hotels to aquarium and kayak operators, the success of many businesses, millions of dollars in fact, in sales and thousands of jobs, directly depend on thriving National Marine Sanctuaries. Across all our National Marine Sanctuaries, about $8 billion annually is generated in local, coastal, and ocean-dependent economies and from diverse activities like commercial fishing, research, education, and recreational tourist activities. So we'll take a quick little walk through our system, and further on in the presentation, we'll talk about some of the specific places. But if you were able to zoom in on this map, you'd see that some of the site's boundaries come really close to shore and others do not. If they come to shore within 3 miles, we at Sanctuaries have developed a real partnership with the states in those places, Hawaii humpback whale, Florida Keys, Olympic Coast, Monterey Bay, and others demonstrate some of the really close ties that we have with the states that we share boundaries with. In some cases, because of our partnerships, we extend the reach of the state to many miles past the 3-mile mark. In the Papahana Mukuakea Marine National Monument, because NOAA and the Department of Interior actually jointly manage the monument with the state of Hawaii and the Office of Hawaiian Affairs, that partnership extends the reach of the state to the 200 nautical mile into the Pacific Ocean.
So Lee, are you on?
Oh, yeah, sorry. I forgot to On mute. So to switch back to the Partnerships for Transboundary Protection Program, as I already mentioned, our species cross geographic and political boundaries, as do their habitats. With this in mind, we identified these overall goals for the PTP program and the priority projects to work towards these goals. So the first goal on the slide refers to the possibility for internal alignment through incorporation of species recovery goals and specific protections for critical habitat and essential fish habitat as examples that can be incorporated into sanctuary management plans. In order to achieve internal alignment, we've selected a couple of sites to start off as kind of pilot areas, and they are the Flower Garden Banks and Monterey Bay Sanctuaries. We'll talk about the Flower Garden Banks a little bit more in some of Vicki's slides. The results of these efforts will be used to create a framework document so that we can assist NOAA staff in furthering collaboration in support of these place-based management efforts and also species conservation efforts within the sanctuaries and beyond, and also serve as a model for working with other collaborators. The second goal on the slide refers to the possibility for incorporating protections for species and their habitats in management plans for marine protected areas outside U.S. waters, such as through the potential expansion of existing sister sanctuary agreements to include management actions to conserve species and habitats that were not necessarily in the original agreement. And the third goal on the slide here refers to the possibility of aligning with international efforts, such as the protocol concerning specially protected areas and wildlife, known as the SPA protocol, toward the protection of species listed under the protocol, like Nassau grouper and some ESA-listed coral species, because they're also protected in U.S. waters under the Endangered Species Act. So, Vicki, I'll switch back to you.
Thank you. The following slides are going to show some existing work within sanctuaries that can serve as examples in this framework document we're developing and could be expanded upon through this partnership to enhance the species and habitat conservation efforts as part of sanctuary management, as well as serving to inform other MPAs about how they might collaborate with the PTP. As mentioned, the Flower Garden Banks National Marine Sanctuary, which is located in the Gulf of Mexico, it's one of the sanctuaries selected as an example of where protected species recovery goals can be integrated with sanctuary management planning process. This integration can serve as an example of place-based management of species and habitat conservation efforts that we're going to inform this framework. Just for your reference, the Flower Garden Banks National Marine Sanctuary is located about 70 to 100 miles offshore the states of Texas and Louisiana, and it's comprised of three discrete areas that are underwater seamounts. It's kind of small in your picture, but it's east and west Flower Garden Banks, which have the red circles around them, and then off further to the west is Stetson Bank, that is part of the current National Marine Sanctuary. Well, these deep underwater seamounts support some of the healthiest coral reef communities in the Gulf of Mexico and wider Caribbean, and the network of banks not only supports coral communities, but also important recreational and commercial fish species and other human uses. So next slide. There are still many unanswered questions that we have about the manta rays that visit the Flower Garden Banks National Marine Sanctuary. We'd like to know more about which species of manta ray visits the sanctuary, how much time do the rays actually spend in the sanctuary, and how large is this visiting population? To help answer these and other questions, since 2006, sanctuary staff have been collaborating with the Wildlife Conservation Society in a shark and ray acoustic tagging effort. With receivers both inside and outside of the sanctuary, researchers can track the movement of animals in the area. And since the deployment of the receivers and tags in 2006, we've noted in this map, you can see kind of the track lines, that two mantas tagged in east traveled to the west bank, which are the red and blue lines on the map. One of these returned to the east bank and made two more trips to the west bank since. And another manta tagged at Stetson traveled to both east and west banks and returned to Stetson Bank, which are the purple lines. In January of 2018, NOAA Fisheries listed the giant manta as threatened under the Endangered Species Act. The giant manta ray is the world's largest ray with a wingspan of up to 29 feet. Giant manta rays are slow-growing migratory animals with small, highly fragmented populations that are sparsely distributed across the world. This data from the manta acoustic tagging research can help inform management actions that could be taken in the sanctuary, as well as to support the species recovery actions in the future. Next slide. Our next example here is at Grays Reef National Marine Sanctuary. This map was, which again, it shows up kind of small, but is the sanctuary itself is 22 square miles of protected area that's located about 16 miles off Sapelo Island, Georgia. The sanctuary includes one of the largest nearshore sandstone reefs in southeastern United States. It's also used by right whales that travel along the Georgia coast. In addition, grouper, black sea bass, mackerel, angelfish, and a host of other fish are also attracted to this reef. And one of the fish that's attracted to this reef is the Atlantic sturgeon, which is shown here in this picture. It's a long-lived, estuarine-dependent, androgynous fish that can grow about 14 feet long and can weigh up to 800 pounds. Atlantic sturgeon in the South Atlantic are listed as endangered under the Endangered Species Act. Historic threats to this species were from commercial fishing, whereas current threats include bycatch, habitat degradation and loss, and ship strikes while they're in the river habitat. Grays Reef National Marine Sanctuary has acoustic receivers placed in to monitor Atlantic sturgeon in the sanctuary as part of a fish tagging effort. Sturgeon movement is tracked along the east coast, and research at the sanctuary is showing how these fish use the bottom reef as at the sanctuary. Sanctuary research programs on the listed species include university partners, the NOAA Fishery Science Centers, and various other NOAA offices. And we're also hoping in this case that this acoustic tagging research can also be used to identify potential partnerships or areas where we can enhance the management and recovery of this important species. Next slide. Okay. My last sanctuary example is on the West Coast at Channel Islands National Marine Sanctuary. And this sanctuary is located about 25 miles off the coast of Santa Barbara, California. The waters around these five islands that make up the sanctuary are a combination of warm and cool currents that bring an exceptional breeding ground for many species of plants and animals. Giant kelp forests are home to numerous populations of fish and invertebrates. And every year, over 27 species of whales and dolphins visit or inhabit the sanctuary. The islands themselves are important to seabird colonies and sea lions. White abalone are endangered throughout its range from California to New Mexico, and there's a picture of one on the slide. In Santa Barbara County, California, at some of the offshore islands and banks, extremely low numbers of isolated survivors have been identified along the mainland coast. The sanctuary is working closely with NOAA Fisheries in the case of white abalone, along with other federal partners and state partners, such as the California Department of Fish and Game, to restore white abalone. Since 2014, the team have used the sanctuary's research vessel called the RV Shearwater to survey abalone habitat along the coast of Santa Barbara and Ventura counties, hopefully to identify areas for reestablishing colonies of white abalones, which are being raised in captivity. Next slide. So the examples that we had gone through here demonstrate, I think, the great potential for this enhanced partnership between sanctuaries and NOAA fisheries in efforts that we can improve the management of protected species and special places through the integration of collaborative research and information that will really guide management activities. In this way, we hope to align sanctuary management plans and species recovery plans for the best benefit of the species and places. National Marine Sanctuary Management Plans, the one here on the left is from Monterey Bay, can include specific strategies and activities to minimize impacts on ESA-listed species within their boundaries and identify future research and monitoring needs that are related to ESA species. In addition, NOAA may have baseline data for places and species outside of our sanctuaries that would be of benefit to other managers, particularly when sites are adjoining or sharing similar characteristics. Next slide.
Okay, so I'll take over now and talk about some additional benefits that we believe can come from this partnership we've been talking about, and giving examples related here specifically to marine mammals. The reason for using marine mammals as an example is because an existing successful outcome of partnerships that the Office of National Marine Sanctuaries already have is, for instance, in the Caribbean, where sister sanctuary agreements include the Carib Tails Program, which is a citizen science program for boaters that involves identifying and tracking individual humpbacks by photos of flukes. Similarly, on the West Coast, staff from NOAA's Olympic Coast National Marine Sanctuary and NOAA Fisheries work together to research critical habitat for the endangered southern resident orcas that are off the coast of Washington. And the sanctuary is also a partner with the White Trail, a nonprofit organization dedicated to whale conservation and shore-based whale watching that reaches more than 22 million people each year. The Whale Trail's outreach efforts are expanding to NOAA sanctuaries in California to encompass a greater portion of the geographic range for southern resident orcas. Similarly, staff at Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary act as first responders with the California Stranding Network and Whale Disentanglement Team. And the staff at the sanctuary also aid protected whales by acting as, the point here is that we think that something with that, like what we're doing with the marine mammals, can also be done for other species through these collaborative efforts, not just with other scientists, but also with the citizen science and other organizations. Vicki, back to you.
Thank you. One key international partnership that NOAA is involved with, as mentioned, is the Protocol on Specially Protected Areas of Wildlife. As the name suggests, the protocol, which covers the wider Caribbean, has efforts to protect both species and areas. The objective of SPA's programs are threefold. One, to significantly increase the number and improve the management of protected and or managed areas in the wider Caribbean region, including support to national and regional conservation management strategies and plans. Secondly, it supports the conservation of threatened and endangered species and sustainable use of natural resources to prevent them from becoming threatened or endangered. And lastly, it develops strong regional capability for information exchange, training, and assistance in support of national biodiversity conservation efforts. 32 protected areas are listed under SPA in 9 countries. These are existing protected areas that are recognized as regionally important. We are now working to better connect the SPA-listed MPAs into a functional network. Next slide.
So Vicki's talked about the actual places. So now going back to the perspective of the species, under the Specially Protected Areas and Wildlife Protocol, there are two examples here shown on this slide of species that are listed under the Endangered Species Act that are also listed under the SPA protocol. On the left, you have the photo of elkhorn corals, which is listed under Annex 2. And then there are also additional, in 2014, NOAA Fisheries listed some additional coral species in the Atlantic and Caribbean as threatened under the Endangered Species Act, and some of them, including the staghorn and elkhorn corals, which were previously listed in 2006, but adding on the boulder star coral and mountainous star coral that were listed in 2014 under the Endangered Species Act are now also under Annex 2. And then also the photo on the right of the Nassau grouper. Nassau groupers are now listed under SPA Protocol Annex 3. And they were listed under the Endangered Species Act in 2016. So again, taking advantage of the places and species to collaborate on potentially achieving some of the recovery goals for these particular animals. Vicki, back to you.
Yes. So one of the benefits of this partnership we wanted to talk about also is connectivity. And MPAs work best when they're connected to one another, so that migratory species and species connected by ocean currents can be protected across their geographic range. Two connectivity benefits that we wanted to focus on are the broadening of sister sanctuary agreements to include focus on other species, and the opportunities for bringing in new partners for protection. And one way that ONMS is connecting this is through the sister site agreements, where we make formal agreements with another country to work on joint conservation goals. This is our sister sanctuary program. For example, Stellwagen Bank National Marine Sanctuary has established agreements with four other countries in the Caribbean to protect a shared population of humpback whales. In addition, agreements were signed with the Dominican Republic in 2006, French Antilles in 2011, Bermuda in 2012, and the Caribbean Netherlands in 2015 to work with MPAs in those countries to enhance research and management on the shared population of humpback whales. This network has significantly expanded protections, originally from just over 2,000 square kilometers in 2007 to over 660,000 square kilometers today. This is all area for humpback whales during their annual migration away from Stellwagen Bank. We want to look at ways to use these agreements to provide additional benefits to the species. Next slide. This is a map of all ONMS's sister site agreements. They offer opportunities to work across international boundaries on common conservation goals. Although there's a lot listed here, we wanted to let you know that the Mexico and Flower Garden Banks with Florida Keys is not yet official, but that will be later this year.
So continuing then with what we see as the benefits of this collaboration, and in this case, not just within NOAA, but also external, are the benefits of monitoring and evaluation to get towards how effective management actions are being, whether or not recovery goals for ESA-listed species are being met. As we've already mentioned, NOAA often has data available, but we know that many partners also have data available that can help inform the effectiveness of management actions and also adaptive management strategies that can be employed in many areas. And this is just an example of tagging a leatherback in an area, a water area that by our Fishery Science Center in the Northeast, and I believe this is actually going on in Stellwagen Bank. So an example of some research on listed species and how those things can be used to benefit and inform conservation and management actions. And Vicki and I are going to share this particular slide, also talk about another benefit that we see, which is building awareness and support for these kind of collaboration activities and the management actions associated with protecting our places and our species. So the first one, the Species in the Spotlight, was launched in 2015 by NOAA Fisheries, particularly the Office of Protected Resources. And it's an initiative to bring attention to the recovery of eight highly at risk of extinction species. And so the reason that these particular species were chosen, and I'll mention what they are in just a second, was because their numbers are considered to be so low that they need to be bred in captivity, or because they're facing significant human threats that have to be addressed to prevent their extinction. And the animals selected for the Species in the Spotlight initiative are the southern resident killer whale, the white abalone, the Atlantic salmon, specifically the Gulf of Maine distinct population segment, coho salmon, specifically the Central California coast, evolutionary significant unit, the Chinook salmon, specifically the Sacramento River winter run evolutionary significant unit, the Pacific leatherback sea turtle, and the Cook Inlet beluga whale, as well as the Hawaiian monk seal. And then Vicki, you wanna talk about the Earth is
So Earth is Blue is an initiative that ONMS has been engaged in order to connect with the public through social media. And primarily this is posting of photos and videos of species and places in various social media outlets. The picture here is an example of one of the, we've had over 1,230 photos posted online as part of Earth is Blue initiative. And this is a picture of the black-footed albatross juvenile from the northwestern Hawaiian islands of Papahanaumokuakea Marine National Monument. Since the program's launch in 2014, we've posted over 1,230 photos. Our Facebook likes have increased by 115,000 since the start of the program. We have 58,200 Instagram followers, Our Twitter followers have increased by 34,000, over 34,000 followers. And in November of 2015, we began a Tumblr account, and we have now just shy of 9,000 followers. And for a program as small as the Office of National Marine Sanctuaries, engaging through social media to not only bring awareness, but in an effort to that enhanced awareness will translate into support for conservation and management of these species and places. It's just one of the platforms that we use to engage the public with the end goal of increasing stewardship. So we are hoping that through this partnership, we can, you know, capitalize on these types of efforts and maybe use them as models to share with other MPA managers.
So the final benefit of this conservation collaboration that we'd like to highlight is the ability to streamline and maximize impact. By targeting conservation capabilities, not only within NOAA, but with partner organizations, and also taking advantage of organizations and volunteer networks, which is the example in the slide here of using Beachwatch to leverage contribution of volunteers to assist NOAA in collecting information on marine mammals and other species. The other benefit of collaborating and kind of knowing what everyone is doing is the ability to reduce duplication and be able to maximize conservation dollars and also maximize efforts through this collaboration with partners that can be facilitated by programs like the PTP program. And that is the end of our presentation. So Lauren, I will turn it back over to you to lead the question and answer.
All right, thank you both, Lee and Vicki, for that presentation. Now I'd like to invite all of those on the webinar to send in any questions or comments that you have. Go ahead and use the Q&A button. You can also use the chat button, either one. And we'd really like to hear from you. So I see that we have one question that's come in so far, or more of a comment, from Jason Holmberg, who says, please consider using open source software wildbook.org for tracking individual humpbacks, flukebook.org, and other species across borders and agencies. It's a good foundation for exactly the shared population data that you're describing, especially with citizen science and computer vision to scale. And he also mentions whaleshark.org and mantamatcher.org. So I don't know if you all are familiar with that, but it sounds like a great resource that we can look into.
Yes, this is Vicki. Thank you, Jason. I'm not personally familiar, being that I'm in the policy side of things, but I think that the suggestion to use open source for kind of capitalizing this is a great suggestion. And I don't know if there's any way to kind of, Lauren, for us to just write a list down that I can take back.
Absolutely. But I appreciate we can capture that.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate the suggestion.
And so another comment that's come in from Anne-Marie Renfola is there any consideration of moving the North Atlantic right whale onto the species in the spotlight? I didn't hear that one on the list. And of course, we've all heard about, you know, a lot of concerns about the right whale population.
Yeah, so the Species in the Spotlight program, at this time, I know that our office is having a lot of meetings about North Atlantic right whale. I'm not sure if Angie is on the webinar who could speak more to the efforts of our office on regarding the right whale. But at this time, the program has been focusing on these particular species and is not planning to change those right now, but it's not meant to be a static thing either. So it could very well be that additional species or will be added, or these particular species, assuming that recovery efforts are successful, might change.
Okay, thanks. So I also have a comment from Alejandro from Pro Natura Noroeste, a nonprofit in Mexico, and he mentions that we are starting to develop projects between Loreto and Channel Islands and wonder how this program could support this collaboration. Are there funds or other resources to enhance collaboration?
other sister parks, I see too. Alejandro, thank you. The PTP program as it is does not currently come with additional resources in terms of financial contributions. What we're really trying in this, you know, infancy stage is to look to see how we can develop the partnerships that will help, you know, leverage those partnerships for mutual benefit, you know, both between sanctuaries and NOAA fisheries and with other MPAs such as the sister sanctuaries. So if the question is related to does the PTP program itself come with additional resources, at this time we really are looking to capitalize on these types of collaborations in order to demonstrate their value and the added value that it has from having these kind of close coordination and connections. As far as the sister sanctuary collaboration specifically, Lauren, I don't know if you want to speak to that.
Yeah, I would just add that we're, you know, very excited about these emerging sister site organizations, partnerships, and certainly we know about the common interest in some of the species shared between those two MPAs. I see that Alejandro is asking, how do we enhance this collaboration? What are the steps? So, Alejandro, I would just suggest that you get in touch with us. You can get in touch with me. It's Lauren, L-A-U-R-E-N dot W-E-N-Z-E-L at NOAA.gov. And we can just make sure to follow up with you because we do have an MOU with Mexico and we're very interested in continuing to support that. So another question that we have, here's a different angle. Tamara Matthew asks, hi, my fourth graders are wondering how you figure out how many species there are in an area.
Oh. You want that one, Vicki? You want me to take one?
I would say go ahead, Lee.
So, depending on the kind of animal you're looking for, there are established survey methods. So I'll give you an example for corals. You typically would lay out what are called transects, which are basically just lines across a habitat area. And then depending on what you're looking for, if you're just looking for everything that's in an area, or if you're focusing on a particular species, then you would move along your transect, and at set intervals, you would be actually then sampling and recording, again, either a particular species or if you're just looking for a general characterization. So there are specific survey techniques, and there are some guides and documents about those. I don't know that we necessarily would have a lot that would be appropriate to a fourth grade audience, but we might, and we can probably check on that. But certainly if there are some, depending on where you're located, if there are some particular species or resources, habitats in your area that you might want to know about how you might go about surveying those sites, feel free to put that into the question or send it to me by email, and we can find some information for you to use for your students.
Yeah, thank you, Lee. This is Vicki. I can also check with Sanctuaries has a really good education and outreach program where we've worked with educators and K through 12 and have established some curriculum related to marine science. And I'd be happy to follow up with our education coordinator to see if there's other resources that we might be able to share with you and your students.
So I'm going to invite people to send in more questions. And while you're doing that, I'll ask some of my own since I have a chance to do that. For both of you, you know, we talked a little bit about connectivity and how important it is to connect these different places and protect these species. And I'm wondering if you can comment on how do we protect these species when they're outside a protected area?
So I can say from an endangered species perspective, the law, while we protect species only in U.S. waters per se, we do have some species that are listed that are outside U.S. waters, and we do work with, there's actually a division in our office that specializes in working internationally, and folks with, well, not just one division, but folks within our office who specialize in that, and making agreements working towards recovery and also doing the status of species. So there are already mechanisms through ESA to do that, to collaborate, I guess, probably similar to what you do with your sister sanctuaries, but in this case, agreements that are more specific to a particular species or group of species.
Yeah, and Lauren, from sanctuaries' perspective, I think that the developing of partnerships, you know, not only with other MPA programs or other federal or state, you know, resource management agencies, but also thinking more broadly about the potential threats to species, whether, you know, they're listed species or important species relative to sanctuaries, but is really working, you know, being open to working with, you know, industry and other types of, you know, maybe not your traditional kinds of partnerships. I was thinking, you know, with the work that Channel Islands National Marine Sanctuary has been doing with the shipping industry and exploring ways that the shipping industry could take voluntary measures to reduce ship speeds in the hopes of reducing ship strikes. There's also a air quality benefit that is of interest there. And so I think it's not only looking at those, you know, those MPA programs where those partnerships that are usually, you know, that may be more governmental or some, you know, organizations based, but being open to working with outside industry partners as well.
Great. And I also want to add to the teacher who asked in her question for her fourth graders, Anne Marie from Stellwagen has also offered to share her seabird research package with the teacher, and it explains how seabirds are surveyed and also some educational background materials. So happy to share that. So another question I would ask both of you is, you know, we've been concentrating here mostly on NOAA since that's where both of our offices are. But of course, the Department of Interior also has responsibilities both for protected areas and for protecting species. And so I'd be interested in hearing from you about how you work with Department of Interior programs and also state programs that have responsibilities for species and places.
Sure, I can start, Lee, if you want. I mentioned before that in the, you know, when you look at the places that sanctuaries manage and that take into consideration that many of them overlap with state waters, some are that are completely within state waters, that these partnerships with state, you know, natural resource, or in our case also heritage resource agencies is a really important one to develop. And in some cases, the four sanctuaries that I mentioned, the Hawaiian Island humpback whale, the Florida Keys, we're developing one with American Samoa, but in some of these places, in Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary has an agreement with the state of Michigan. In some of these places where we really are overlapping in those state waters, we've developed, you know, specific agreements with the state that outline, you know, how we're going to work together and outlining opportunities to identify, you know, co-management priorities that are of benefit to both the state and to the sanctuary in general, even including, you know, that we may manage more than just the state water portion. So I think, and also then in the case of Papahana Mukuakea Marine National Monument, that monument has, as I mentioned, the four co-trustees, which includes Department of Interior and the Fish and Wildlife Service in managing, you know, these places. So sometimes it's just about, I think, establishing a framework for how you're going to work together and making sure that those communication lines are open and that you have a collaborative opportunity to identify priorities. So
thanks.
Sure.
So Lauren, I'll answer that from the perspective of protected resources. So under the Endangered Species Act, the Endangered Species Act actually is for both services. So the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, which is under DOI, and the National Marine Fisheries Service. So we have joint authority under the Endangered Species Act. So we work together a lot on many of the, for instance, regulations and consultations, which is Section 7 of the Endangered Species Act, with the service to develop joint guidance in a lot of cases, and also to just implement the requirements of the law. So, and there are some places where we have shared authority for a species, such as the case for just to give one example, because there are a couple, green sea turtles, leatherback sea turtles, hawksbills. So sea turtles are the responsibility of Fish and Wildlife in terms of Section 7 consultations when they're on land, and they're the responsibility of NIMS when they're in the water. So we have shared authorities, and we do work together that way under Endangered Species Act. There are other places where we work together when the landscape conservation cooperatives are fully operational. NIMS often has members sitting on those conservation cooperatives to be part of steering committees and working committees and things like that, because many of those do go from land to sea. For instance, in the Caribbean, that's the case. And then in terms of state, so again, under the Endangered Species Act, Section 6 actually has, that is specifically for coordination with states and territories for management of and conservation of listed species. So that allows for us to enter into cooperative agreements with states and territories that have the authority to conserve, manage, protect, take actions towards management and recovery of listed species and designated critical habitat, and they can get funding through Section 6 of the law. So that's basically how, just to highlight, you know, under the Endangered Species Act, how we work together. And I would also say, Lauren, this is like totally separate from that question, but it looks like you have a bunch of things in the chat too. So I don't know if you're checking the chat as well.
Yep, I've been checking both. Thanks. So we do have a couple of other questions that have just come in the Q&A. And one is PTP involved in the collaboration with the Canadian government to prevent additional mortalities of right whales during the summer months?
So again, the right whale issue is an issue that the Office of Protected Resources is working with. It's not specifically part of PTP. As right now, the way we had started PTP was with the Office of National Marine Sanctuaries and the Office of Protected Resources. I can see where right whale certainly could be part of some of the work that we are hoping to do under PTP as we expand some sister sanctuary agreements through sanctuaries and do some other work with sanctuaries and with other partners outside of NOAA and within NOAA. But right now, the issues related to the mortalities of right whales are being handled outside of PTP.
But do you know, understanding that they're being handled outside PTP, do you know if there is active work with Canada to try to address this mortality issue?
So that's a different part of my office. So I know that there have been lots of meetings with lots of entities, but I don't know if Angie's actually on the webinar and could respond to that in chat or the question section. I can certainly find out, but my section does not deal with the marine mammals. So yeah, I'd have to refer you to the marine mammal division.
We can follow up offline. So another question is, that the current administration has asked for public comment on reducing or eliminating some of our sanctuaries and marine monuments. Do you know if this is happening or the status of this action, and how devastating would this be if it happens?
So this is Vicki. So the executive orders related to review of national marine sanctuaries and marine national monuments, it's really at this point, that there's the development of a report that from the Department of Interior, I believe that their report related to the executive order for the review is considering submission of some recommendations to the White House. The counterpart to that the Department of Commerce has been working on the review is purely an informational report looking at those specific criteria that were outlined in the executive order, and really the ultimate decision on what, if any, action to take will be under the purview of the White House. So it's not something at this time, at my level, definitely, that I have any ability to comment on.
Thanks. And I just have one more question at the moment, but I'll see up, and here's another. Around another international issue, how does NOAA communicate with Chukotka and the Russian Federation regarding shared marine resources in the transboundary Bering Strait region? And I will just say up front that if folks don't have the details on this, we can definitely answer this offline, because I know that we do have some discussions with Russia and some active work with the Park Service and the Fish and Wildlife Service and others based in Alaska.
Yeah, I mean, we have people who work internationally, like I already mentioned, and we also have the Office of International Affairs who handle some of the interactions. But I think that might be a better one for offline. I mean, I know in terms of research, there is collaboration, including transfer of samples and things like that for a lot of the marine mammal research. But I think that might be a better one to follow up on offline.
Okay, great. And I will just add to that, of course, through the Arctic Council, there is work going on to promote a pan-Arctic network of marine protected areas. And that is an opportunity to bring together people from across the Arctic to share information at the technical level and at the planning level about what their individual countries are doing with respect to protected areas and also species conservation. All right, well, I think at the moment I only have one other question, and it asks, are staff exchanges a part of the PTP effort, or are they envisioned in the future?
That's really a great question.
No, that's what I was going to say.
Talked about that as a possibility, but I will say that there are certainly always some NOAA internship opportunities and things like that. And I know that there are similar opportunities within the federal government to take some of those opportunities, but they are at NOAA level, they're not at PTP level, but I think it's a great question and it's something that we can certainly consider in terms of potentially making a request to have an internship, assuming that we would, because they don't come for free. So we'd have to figure out within our offices if there was a funding for that particular opportunity, but there certainly I think that's a great idea to explore that we had not thought of.
Okay. Well, I just want to thank both of our speakers. It's been a great topic and really interesting, and I want to thank all of our participants for sending in your questions, and we will follow up with you on the ones that needed a little bit more information offline. So thanks, everyone, and thanks to our speakers, and we will post this webinar online at OCTO, so you can look for it there.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks, Lauren.